सहनावतु सहनोभुनक्तु सहवीर्यं करवावहै तेजस्विनावधीतमस्तु मा विद्विषावहै ॐ शान्ति शान्ति शान्ति। सदाशिवसमारंभां शंकराचार्यमध्यमां अस्मदाचार्यपर्यन्तां वंदे गुरुपरंपरां श्रुतिस्मृतिपुराणानां आलयं करुणालयं नमामि भगवत्पादं शंकरं लोकशंकरं शंकरं शंकराचार्यं केशवं बादरायणं सूत्रभाष्यकृतौ वंदे भगवन्तौ पुनः पुनः समस्तजनकल्याणे निरतं करुणामयं नमामि चिन्मयं देवं सद्गुरुं ब्रह्मविद्वरं सद्गुरुं ब्रह्मविद्वरं। ॐ पूर्णमदः पूर्णमिदं पूर्णात् पूर्णमुदच्यते पूर्णस्य पूर्णमादाय पूर्णमेवावशिष्यते। ॐ शान्ति शान्ति शान्तिः। ॐ ईशावास्यमिदगं सर्वं यत्किञ्च जगत्यां जगत् तेन त्यक्तेन भुञ्जीथाः मा गृधः कस्य स्विद्धनं कुर्वन्नेवेह कर्माणि जिषि विषेच्छतगं समाह एवं त्वयि नान्यथेतोऽस्ति न कर्म लिप्यते। असुर्यानामते लोकाः अंधेन तमसावृताः तागंस्ते प्रेत्याभिगच्छन्ति ये के चात्महनो जनाः अनेजदेकं मनसो जवीयः नैनद्देवा आप्नुवन् पूर्वमर्षत तद्धावतोऽन्यानत्येति तिष्ठत तस्मिन्नपो मातरिष्वा दधाति।
सो द उपनिषद् बिगिन्स् विद् दि ग्रेटेस्ट् reality that the whole world is nothing but a manifestation of God alone. So the commandment of the teacher is, if you want everything auspicious to happen in your life, if you want to bless yourself, if you want to really enjoy your life, there is only one way: see the Lord in everything, see yourself in everything. This way you live. There is none other than you in the whole world. But if this vision is difficult, There is no choice. You must get this vision. If you are not able to cultivate this vision, then cultivate the mind so that you can gain this vision. If you are finding it difficult, it is only because your mind is not prepared. So prepare your mind through Karma Yoga. So performing actions for the sake of the Lord, for the welfare of all, selflessly, in this way, you must desire to live for 100 years. In this way, if you perform action, then these actions will not bind you. Other than this, there is no other way for you. So, purify the mind through Karma Yoga, gain the knowledge through Jnana Yoga, and liberate yourself. But suppose you refuse to live this way, then such people, ye shastravidhim utsrujya vartate kamakaratah nasa siddhim avapnoti na sukham na param gatim. Those people who live a licentious life without following the injunctions of the scriptures, they are neither happy here nor hereafter. Yesterday we had seen in Bhagavatam also the elaboration of this verse. Asuryanamate lokaha andhena tamasavrutaha. They go to worlds covered with blinding darkness. Tanste pretyabhigacchanti ekecha atmahano janaha. So this term is very much used in the Upanishad. Suicides. People who commit suicide. They are killing their own self. Even though Sakshat Bhagavan is there as their own self, not away from them, as their own self it is there. Bliss, happiness, perfection, everything is their birthright, but still they lose everything. On the other hand, they suffer. So in the first verse it was said, the whole world has to be pervaded by Isha. So naturally the question is, who is this Isha? Who is this Lord? So now there is a description about Isha. So what is being said here? Verse number 4. Anejat, first term, that which doesn't move. Ekam, that which is one. Manaso javiyah, faster than the mind. Deva na enat apnuvan, the devatas could not overtake this. Why? Purvam arshat, because it had already ran ahead. It ran ahead, therefore the devatas could not overtake it. Tad dhavatah anyan atyeti. It overtakes all the others which were running. How? Tishtat. Remaining at one place, it overtakes everyone who were running. Asmin apo matarishva dadati. In him, matarishva, air, apaha dadati, holds water. Now what does this mean? So now let us take term by time. The first one is anejat. Anejat means that which doesn't move. So that supreme truth, that infinite consciousness cannot move. Why? Because it is infinite. Infinite cannot move. But also anejat can mean not moving means what? Not falling from its pristine glory. Achyutaha, infallible. So that supreme truth is existence. It can never become non-existent. So whatever the properties are there, those properties remain forever without any change. So whatever the properties, like existence, it can never become non-existent. It is consciousness, therefore it can never become inert. It is truth, so naturally it can never become untruth. So never falling from its supreme state. That also can be a beautiful meaning, anejata. Then ekam, it is only one. Though it appears to be many, it is only one. So when we pay attention to the limiting adjuncts, the conditionings, it appears to be many. So each and every living being is expressing that consciousness as life. So it appears as though we are all very many. But what is the Upanishad saying? The consciousness in everyone is the same. Just like there are very many pots, so it appears as though the pot spaces are different, but actually what is the truth? The space is only one, though it appears many. Because it comes in contact with the different conditionings, the different conditionings appear to limit the infinite. So this consciousness, though it appears to be different in different beings, it is only one. Ekam. And moreover, that which is infinite has to be one alone. You cannot have two infinites. Then manasojaviyaha, faster than the mind. Now what does it mean? Which is the fastest thing in this world? According to science, it is light. But according to spirituality, it is mind. And it's a fact, it is mind alone. Wherever you want to go, you can. In a flash of a second. So many millions of light years away, if there is a world called Brahmaloka, you can just, in a flash of a second, you can go there. Provided you have already gone there. In your mind, you can bring Swarga or Naraka in a flash of a second. So we say, mind is the fastest. But now here, what is being said here? This consciousness is faster than the mind. Why do we say it? There can be very many explanations given. Suppose you want to go to Swarga. So the moment you think of Swarga, so those Swarga is already existing. You think of it. Now the Swarga is in front of you. Is it existing or non-existing? There is an easiness, isn't it? When you perceive through your mind, there is an easiness, but that ease, I-S, existence, belongs to whom? Belongs to consciousness. The consciousness is Sat Swarupa. So even before the mind has conceived of it, consciousness is already there as existence. Isn't it? One reason. Second reason, who gives sentiency to the mind? Mind by itself is matter. It has no life. So even as the mind is conceiving that object, there is this consciousness enabling the mind to conceive that object by giving sentiency. Isn't it? The mind is functioning because of consciousness. So even before mind has reached there, that ability to reach, that ability has been given by consciousness. So we can figuratively say, now remember, these are all figurative expressions. So we can say, consciousness is faster than mind. But philosophically what it means is, consciousness is faster than mind means mind cannot think of consciousness. So what is consciousness? Achintyaha. This is the meaning. Mind cannot think of consciousness. you can only be conscious of mind. You can only be conscious of thoughts. The gross cannot grasp the subtle. Mind is gross. Consciousness is subtle. It is only the subtle which can grasp the gross. This is the meaning. Achintyah. Then, na enat deva apnuvan. Devatas could not overtake him. Again the same figurative expression. Why? Purvam arshat. It ran ahead of it. So who are these devatas? Dyotanat devah. We are not talking of some devatas. We are talking of senses. Indriyas. Divyate prakashati iti devah. That which illumines is called deva. So what do the senses do for us? It illumines shabda, sparsha, rupa, rasa, gandha. Right? It illumines. So through eyes, the forms and colors are illumined. That knowledge of form and color come through the eyes. The knowledge of sound is illumined by the ears. Illumined means what? When the light falls on something, we are able to see. In the same way, it appears as though light beams are shooting out through our senses in order to make us perceive the sense objects. So each and every sense organ is compared with light. So that is why the senses are called devata. So what is said here? This consciousness ran ahead of devatas. Meaning what? Even when the senses shoot out to perceive the sense object, the consciousness is already there as the existence of that sense object. Even when the sense organ shoot out, consciousness is already there as the sentiency giving principle for the sense organs. Both here and there it is there. So therefore, figuratively we can say consciousness ran ahead of them. Philosophically, what it means is consciousness is indriya agocharah, that which cannot be perceived by the senses. Consciousness cannot be perceived by the senses. On the other hand, it is because of consciousness that sense organs are able to function. They gain their sentiency because of consciousness. This is the meaning. So what all points have come? So this consciousness is infinite. This consciousness is only one. This consciousness is beyond the mind and the senses. It is achintyah, it is indriya agocharah. Also, this consciousness is chaitanya surupah, enlivening the matter equipments. Then, taddhavatah anyan atteti tishtat, remaining in one place, it overtakes all. Meaning what? Suppose there is a flight from Mangalore to Mumbai. So as the flight started, there was space. But the flight, when it reaches Mumbai, the space is already there. So we can say the space has overtaken the flight. How did it overtake? By remaining there itself. Even before the flight landed in Mumbai, the space was there. How could it be? Because it is all pervading. Remaining in one place, it overtakes. It happens with the sun also. So there is sunrise here and the flight starts. And you reach Mumbai, the sun is already there. Sun was here, now the same sun is seen there also. Why is it so? The light is all pervading. Therefore, again, the thing is the same. They are all figurative expressions to point out that consciousness is infinite and all-pervading. Now comes the next line. Tasmin apaha matarishva dadhati. In it, matarishva, air, holds water. Tasmin apo matarishva dadhati. What does it mean? It means a lot. First of all, what is this matarishva? Matari shvayati iti matarishva. Matari in space, shvayati which moves. What moves in space? What moves in space? Air. So matarishva, one meaning is air. Tasmin, in it, in that consciousness, in that isha, matarishva apaha dadhati. Air dadhati holds, supports, apaha, water. Now what does it mean? First meaning is a simple meaning, science. From the standpoint of science, what is water? H2O. What is H2O? Hydrogen and oxygen. So who holds whom? Can water exist without oxygen? So therefore we can say oxygen holds water. True? If you remove oxygen, water cannot exist. So we can say, what can we say? Matrishva apaha dadhati. Isn't it? See, oxygen can survive without water. Water cannot survive without oxygen. So we can say oxygen supports. Oxygen means air supports water. This is from a very scientific standpoint. Little more higher. In this, what you call, air, you'll find humidity. So we can say the air is supporting water in the environment also. That's also true. Water vapors are supported by the air. That is also true. Now, little more deeper. Here, this vayu or the air, what is mentioned here is the prana shakti at the vyashti level, at the individual level now we'll take. The prana shakti is called matarishva here. So what is the role of prana shakti? It keeps the body alive, isn't it? Through different physiological functions. Prana, apana, vyana, udana, samana. Through pancha pranas, it keeps the body alive. Now what is said here? These pancha pranas support water. Now we all know in this body, 75% to 80% is water alone. Isn't it? So if water is remaining in the body without getting evaporated, who is the cause? It is this prana shakti. Because we are alive, the water is there. And because the water is there, the shape of the body is maintained. What is said here is tasmin. It is not because of its own power that prana shakti is able to keep the body alive. It is because of him that prana shakti is able to keep the body alive. Tasmin, because of his presence. So in Kathopanishad it is said, na pranena na apanena martyo jivati kashchana itarena tu jivanti yasminneta upashritau. It is not because you are breathing that you are alive. You are inhaling and exhaling. It is not because of your inhalation and exhalation that you are alive. It is because of him, a different factor, that you are able to breathe, because of which there is life. The moment water is taken away from the body, what happens? What remains? Only powder remains. If water content is, what you call, dehydration. If the whole water is taken away, the body is reduced to powder. So what gives shape to this body? It is water. What holds water? It is Pranashakti. Why Pranashakti is able to do this? Tasmin, because of him. It is that Supreme Lord as consciousness which enables the pranas to support water in the body, meaning to enliven the body. It is at the Vyashti level. At the Samashti level, what we have to understand is all the activities that are happening in the world, that is also happening because of Pranashakti. The Samashti Pranashakti is taking care of the entire cosmos. Lot of movements are happening in this. Earth moving, sun moving, so many galaxies are moving. How are they moving? It is again because of this Pranashakti. Where did that prana get the Shakti? From the Lord. This is another meaning. Right. Now, here Bhagavan Shankaracharya takes the meaning of apaha as activities and dadhati as allots. So because of him, tasmin, matarishva apaha dadhati. Because of him, all the presiding deities like Vayu Devata are allotted their respective activities. It is because of him, or rather, he is the one who has given different responsibilities to different cosmic deities like Vayu Devata. That's also beautiful meaning. So that we have seen in Bhagavatam. It is because of him that the sun shines, the air flows, water flows, the fire is able to burn. So all those cosmic deities are able to perform their function well. From where did that get their strength from? It is from the Supreme Lord. This is another meaning. See, so many meanings are coming out of it, you see. Now, another meaning. He is the one who gives karma phala to the jivas. Matarishva, another meaning is jivas. So under his guidance, the jivas, according to their karmas, receive their karma phalas. He is the one who allots karma phalas to jivas. This is another meaning. So what all meaning have we seen? At the scientific level, yes, H2O. At the environment level, yes, it is the air which holds water. But at the philosophical level, Bhagavan is the law giver, law administrator, he is the karma phaladata, and also he is the sentiency giving principle. All these meaning come with this small word, tasminnapo matarishva dadhati. Bhagavan, that supreme consciousness, as Hiranyagarbha, as Ishvara, gives karma phalas not only to the jivas, but to the cosmic presiding deities also. These Vayu Devata, Surya Devata, etc., they are also jivas only. But because they have done lot of punya karmas, they are elevated to such a, what you call, powerful post. So all those things, all those are also jivas, but they have been given the power by him alone. The Lord alone is the, what you call, source of all power. So this way we have to understand. The very same idea is again mentioned in the next verse, page 109. Tade jati tannai jati taddure tadvantike
तदंतरस्य सर्वस्य तदु सर्वस्यास्य बाह्यतः तदेजति तन्नैजति तद्दूरे तद्वन्तिके तदंतरस्य सर्वस्य तदु सर्वस्यास्य बाह्यतः
यस तद् एजति इट मूव्स तत् न एजति इट डजंट मूव देन तद् दूरे इट इज वेरी फार तद् वन्तिके इट इज वेरी नियर आल्सो तद् अंतरस्य सर्वस्य इट इज देयर इनसाइड ऑल ओनली इनसाइड नो तदु सर्वस्यास्य बाह्यतः इट इज देयर आउटसाइड आल्सो वॉट इज दिस इट मूव्स इट डजंट मूव इट इज इनसाइड इट इज आउटसाइड इट इज नियर इट इज फार सो फर्स्ट वन लेट अस टेक इट मूव्स एंड इट डजंट मूव Now, what does it mean? Now, there are two standpoints. One is absolute standpoint and the other is relative standpoint. So, with respect to standpoints, two statements are made. One is without conditioning, the other is with conditioning. So, with respect to two standpoints, statements are made. Just like the sun setting and rising, it is with respect to what? With respect to earth, the sun rises and sets, but with respect to sun, there is no rising and setting. The same way here. Tad ejati, it moves. With respect to the conditionings, it appears to move. So all the jivatmas, they move around. So it appears as though consciousness is moving. Isn't it? Suppose there is a pot filled with water and you see the reflection of the sun. As you move the pot, what do you see? You see as though the sun is also moving. But actually that movement is the movement of the conditioning, not the movement of the sun. So with respect to conditioning, this consciousness appears to move. But from its own standpoint, tat na ejati, it doesn't move. So the standpoint matters. Very many times we sit in the bus, travel hundreds of kilometers, come. So have you traveled? No and yes. I did not travel, I was only sitting. So from the standpoint of my body, there was no traveling. But with respect to the bus or the train or the flight, yes, traveling is there. So both are true. The question is from which standpoint? In the same way, the consciousness moves with respect to the condition. It appears to move with respect to the conditioning, but from its own standpoint, there is no movement. Then, tad dure tad vantike. It is dure, very far, at the same time it is very near. So what does it mean? Just like space. Because it is infinite, it is far place also it is there, near also it is there. But here Bhagavan Shankaracharya gives a nice meaning. Tad dure, it is far. Varsha koti shatairapi avidusham apraapyatvat dura eva. Varsha koti shatairapi. How many years? Kotisha, Shatakoti Varsha is how much? 100 crores of years. Avidusham, the ignorant fellows. Aprapyatvat, because he is not going to find it. Dura eva. Even after 100 crores of years, an ignorant person is not going to gain it. A person with an impure mind is not going to gain it. Therefore, it appears as though it is far, far away. But, tadvantike means what? Taduvantike, samipe, atyantameva, vidushaam atmatvat. For a wise man, it is very near. Why it is very near? This supreme truth is none other than his own self. So even to say that it is near is wrong. It is he himself. It is so near. So for an ignorant person, it is very, very far. For a wise person, it is very near. Tad antarasya sarvasya. It is inside all. Tadu sarvasyasya bahyatah. It is outside all. So inside all, it is experienced as chit surupa, consciousness. Outside, it is experienced as sat surupa, existence. So outside you see the existence of all. The Bhagwan as sat surupa is experienced outside. Bhagwan as chit swarupa, consciousness, is experienced inside. Bhagwan as atma is experienced inside. Bhagwan as sarva adhara is experienced outside. The support of all. He is inside as well as outside. Just like the space, it is inside the pot also, outside the pot also. In fact, the fact is, pot is inside the space. Space is not inside the pot, pot is inside the space. Antarasya sarvasya tadu sarvasyasya bahyatah. Okay. Now, what is the benefit of gaining this knowledge? Next verse. A Mahatma is described. Page number 112.
Yastu sarvani bhutani atmanyevanupashyati sarvabhuteshu chatmanam ततो न विजुगुप्सते यस्तु सर्वाणि भूतानि आत्मन्येवानुपश्यति सर्वभूतेषु चात्मानं ततो न विजुगुप्सते.
यः तु द वन हु सर्वाणि भूतानि आत्मनियेव अनुपश्यते. ही सीज सर्वाणि भूतानि ऑल बीइंग्स आत्मनियेव इन वन्स ओन सेल्फ. ही सीज ऑल बीइंग्स इन वन्स ओन सेल्फ एंड सर्वभूतेषु च आत्मानं अनुपश्यते. ही सीज द सेल्फ इन ऑल बीइंग्स. ही सीज ऑल बीइंग्स इन द सेल्फ एंड सेल्फ इन ऑल बीइंग्स. सच ए पर्सन ततः न विजुगुप्सते. ही जस्ट कैनॉट हैव डिसलाइक और हेट्रेड और रिवल्शन अनटू एनीवन. न विजुगुप्सते. हेटिंग अदर्स बिकम इम्पॉसिबल फॉर हिम. दिस ऑल्सो वी हैव सीन अर्लियर. नाउ दिस वर्स इट अपियर्स एज दो इट हैज बीन लिटरली कॉपीड बाय भगवान कृष्णा इन हिज भगवद्गीता. Very similar expression comes there in 6th chapter. All beings in the self in all beings. Here the term used is anupashyati, not just pashyati, anupashyati. What is anu? Anu means followed by. Followed by what? Followed by Guru Upadesha. After having taught by the teacher, guided by the teacher, now he sees. Anu also means continuous. Continuously he sees, not now and then. Anu also means aparokshataya. It is not just an intellectual knowledge, it is his experience. Anupashyati. So what does he see? All beings in the self. The self in all beings. Now what does it mean? Sarvani bhutani atmani. First, let us take that. All the beings in the self. So if we observe our experience, the whole world is existing in the mind. And where is the mind existing? In consciousness. So we can say, Sarvani bhutani atmani pashyati. All the beings exist in the self. So what is the supporter? Self is the supporter. It's true. The world is seen in the mind. When the mind goes away, world also goes away. When the mind comes, world also comes. In deep sleep, we don't experience the world because mind is not there. So whenever the mind comes, the world comes. So therefore, we can say the mind supports the world. But where is the mind existing? Mind means thoughts. Thoughts exist in consciousness. So we can say consciousness is the support for the whole world. Thus we can say the self is the support. So all the beings exist in the self. Now the next statement is the self in all beings. The self as the very life principle is very clearly inferred in all beings. What is that life principle in us? It is because of the self. So thus we can say self is there in all beings. So all beings in the self in all beings. Right. Now there is another way of looking at it. If this condition has to follow, A is in B and B is in A, this condition can be satisfied only if one is reality and the other is illusion. Wave in water and water in wave. Can you see it? You can see. You can say wave is there in water and water is there in the wave. You can say. Why? There is only water. Wave is only a nama rupa. It doesn't have any existence. It is only the name of a form. It has no existence. It is an illusion. So when you say A is in B and B is in A, know for sure there is one thing which is an illusion and one thing which is real. So here, which is the reality and which is the illusion? Sarvabhutani atmani atmanam sarvabhuteshu. So this sarvabhutani is nothing but names and forms. It has no reality. What exists is only Atma. So what is the vision of this Mahatma? He sees only Atma everywhere. That is the point. He sees Atma alone everywhere, which was defined earlier as Isha. For such a person who is seeing only himself everywhere, na vijugupsate, he cannot hate. Dvayat bhayam bhavati. Dvayat, from that vision of difference, from the vision of duality comes all the negativities of the mind like fear, hatred, etc. So what is the benefit of this knowledge? All the negativities of the mind disappears. Verse number 7 also talks about the same Mahatma. Let us chant that. Page number 116. Yasmin sarvani bhutani atmai vabhut vijanatah tatra ko mohah kashokah एकत्वमनुपश्यतः यस्मिन् सर्वाणि भूतानि आत्मैवाभूत् विजानतः तत्र को मोहः कः शोकः एकत्वमनुपश्यतः. यस्,
यस्मिन् द वन पर्सन हु सर्वाणि भूतानि आत्म एव अभूत फॉर द वन फॉर हुम ऑल द बीइंग्स हैव बिकम हिज आत्मा एलोन इन सच ए पर्सन अनुपश्यत वन हु सीज दस आजा आई मीन भूतानि आत्मैवाभूत विजानतः द वन हु हैज गेन्ड दिस नॉलेज that all the beings are none other than his own self. For such a person, tatra ko moha ka shokaha. Where is moha? Where is delusion for him? Where is shoka for him? Why? Ekatvam anupashyataha. He sees oneness. The same idea. So what is the source of moha and shoka? In fact, from moha comes shoka. From delusion comes sorrow. And what is the delusion? Delusion is the wrong notion that I am this body. I am not consciousness, I am the body. That is the wrong notion. Now we have discussed all this very many times. So it is only a revision now what we are doing. The starting point of delusion is avidya. Avidya means ignorance, self-ignorance. And what is the self-ignorance? I am this body. From this ignorance comes moha, delusion. And with this delusion we do so many things. And what is the end result of actions born out of delusion? The end result is shoka, suffering. Remember that chain. I know, I desire, I act, I reap the result, the end result. If the beginning was ignorance, what will be the result? Sorrow. That sorrow forces the person to correct his so-called knowledge. Right? The end result of any action done under the misguidance of ignorance is sorrow. The end result is sorrow. And you will find that whatever gives you sorrow, if you start finding the root cause, you will find it is all because of actions performed because of body identification. Actions performed because of body identification is called selfish actions. So what is the end result of selfish actions? Suffering alone, pain alone. So the cause of shoka is moha. The cause of moha is identification. Identification with the body. Now this Mahatma, what is the thing he has done? He is not identified with the body, he is identified with his own self. So because his identification is with the self, he sees the very same self everywhere. And because he sees the very same self everywhere, naturally his actions will be selfless, good for the welfare of all. So for such a person, where is the question of shoka? Shoka at the adhyatmika level, at the adhibhautika level, at the adhidevika level. So what is the end result of this knowledge? Dukkha nivritti and sukha prapti. This is the end result. There is nothing much to say. Everything has been said already. So what has to be done in order to become happy in life? Ishavasyamidagam sarvam. See Bhagavan alone, which is your own self everywhere. Tena tyaktena bhunjita. Renounce your foolish, faulty, divisive vision. Replace that vision with this right vision. Then only that bhoga comes. Real bhoga is this. Bhunjita. Real enjoyment is this. then there is only happiness all the time. Is there any other way? There is no other way. This is the essential message of Ishavasya Upanishad. Now the next verse is again a repetition, summarizing the whole thing again. Whatever has been discussed about that Isha, once again the Rishi mentions. And actually with the next verse, really speaking, Ishavasya Upanishad is over. Then come certain instructions which are meant for the seekers. All that we will see in the next class. Now we'll sit in silence for some time.